In this episode of the Happy Diabetic Kitchen Podcast, we talk with my very good friend and an expert in the diabetes field, Mr. Max Szadek. You might know him as Mr. Divabetic. Stay tuned. This episode of the Happy Diabetic Kitchen Podcast is sponsored by my diabetes supplier, US Med. US Med offers free shipping and a 90-day supply with every order. To see how they can simplify your diabetes care, call 1-877-840-8218. I did, and I can feel the love. Remember, there is a much better solution, US Med. Hello, everyone. I am Chef Robert Lewis, the Happy Diabetic, and welcome to the Internet's most delicious cooking podcast. I'm here in the kitchen getting ready to explore a healthy diabetic lifestyle. I want to take the mystery out of healthy cooking and explore some amazing foods and my diabetic journey with my successes and my challenges. Let me help you live your best happy diabetic lifestyle. So welcome to the kitchen. And if you're new to the show, I'm happy you're here. And with me always in the kitchen is my son, Jason, engineer, producer of the podcast. This week, he is on special assignment. So if you're ready to go, let's get cooking. Podcast is dedicated to Luther Vandross. You heard him sing his amazing rendition of Impossible Dream. And today, our interview is with Max Szadek, otherwise known as Mr. Divabetic. Max lives in New York City and is doing amazing work in the diabetic world. Our recipe of the podcast is our oven-roasted salmon with fruit salsa. And I'm going to talk about my tips I learned from my cooking school, the other CIA, the Culinary Institute of America in Hyde Park, New York. So, if you're ready to go, stay tuned, and let's head to the kitchen. All right, everybody, it's time for the recipe of the podcast. My oven-roasted salmon with fruit salsa. You are going to love this dish. Simple and easy. Good for you. High in omega-3s. Your family will love it. So here's what you're going to need. And by the way, you will find this recipe on happydiabetic.com. Go to my favorites, and you'll see it right there. So let's just talk about the ingredients. Now, you can use fresh or canned for this fruit. Mango, fresh or canned pineapple. Fresh strawberries would be best, some lime juice, some fresh cilantro, 4 6-ounce salmon fillets, 2 tablespoons of Splenda or Stevia, and some ground pepper. That's the ingredients. So simple. Let's put it together. You're going to peel and dice the mango and the pineapple. Unless you're buying it canned, it'll already be peeled and probably diced. And we're going to put them in a bowl. We're going to add the diced strawberries, some lime juice, some cilantro, and we're going to set that aside to just get all those flavors melded. So we're going to season the salmon with some cracked pepper and a light dusting of Splenda or Stevia. Then you're going to take your sauté pan with a little bit of olive oil, heat it up till it shimmers, not very much, just a light coating, and you're going to place the fish flesh side down on a non-stick ovenable pan that's lightly coated with olive oil or canola oil if you like. Then we're going to place the salmon in a preheated 425-degree oven after it gets nice and brown and crusty. And we're going to cook the fish for about 10 to 12 minutes. Now, you can cook the fish and it'll be firm to the touch. And we're looking for an internal temperature of about 120 to 140 degrees, somewhere in there. If you like it at 120, the salmon will be medium rare. If you like it at 140, it'll be completely cooked. So then we're going to remove it from the oven. We're going to let it sit for 2 to 3 minutes. We love it to rest, right? Let it relax and get all those juices melded inside. Place the fish on the plate. top with your fruit salsa, and you are ready to go. That's it. My amazing oven-roasted salmon with fruit salsa. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, or want to reach out to me about this recipe, go to happydiabetic.com, hit the contact link, and I will get back to you as soon as I can. Thanks, everybody. Stay tuned. We've got more on the way. All right, it's time for my cooking tips that I learned at culinary school. So, my number one tip today is going to be use a damp towel to keep the cutting board in place. It can be so annoying to try to chop on a cutting board that keeps sliding all over the counter. Lock it in place by placing a damp paper towel or a damp dish towel underneath it. And listen, if you're taking good care of your cutting boards, always wash and sanitize whenever you're done cutting and cooking. All right, we'll be right back with our interview of the podcast, Mr. Max Szadek, Mr. Divabetic. Stay tuned. Okay, everybody, welcome back to the Happy Diabetic Kitchen Podcast. I'm here with my special guest that I can't wait to introduce and for you all to meet. Max, good morning.
Good morning. Thanks for having me on the podcast.
I'm so excited. So, Max, I have to ask you a question. Are you ready to get happy?
I am. I actually, every morning I say I'm happy, I'm healthy, I am the best, and I deserve the best. So I went on my walk this morning. That's my affirmation every day and usually puts me in a great mood.
I love it. So I've known Max for many, many, many years. I was trying to think, Max, it might even be 15 years since I first met you at a TCOID conference. It might be something like that.
I agree.
So why don't you just tell all the happy diabetics out there who are listening a little bit about you and kind of fill in the blanks.
Well, I loved meeting you at that event. I just want to say, like, taking control of your diabetes, what a great outreach event. Got to have the opportunity to do several and to keep seeing you around the country motivating people with diabetes. My journey in diabetes really happened because I was a personal assistant for a singer named Luther Vandross. And so I was working with Luther Vandross ultimately I worked for him for 13 years, and I live in New York City. And in April of 2003, I went to Luther's house because he was renovating his house on Fifth Avenue, and I knocked on the door and he didn't answer. And that wasn't like Luther. He was very punctual. And when he didn't answer, I was just kind of surprised. And ultimately I had to break down the door. And that's when I found Luther, who was living with type 2 diabetes, had a stroke. And so I was the one who took him to the hospital. And when we got to emergency and they wheeled Luther in, the doctor came out and he said to me, you know, this could have been prevented. So, you know, that's how the journey started. I have a grandmother on my mother's side who had diabetes. So I knew Luther had diabetes. But like a lot of people, I was just knew he took medications. I didn't really know how you manage type 2 diabetes specifically. And his stroke was, I really think, related to mismanagement of type 2 diabetes.
Yeah, I think that's a very common theme amongst people living with diabetes. And I know that's your mission. I know that's one of my missions, to help people to live a better lifestyle with diabetes.
Yeah. So, you know, what happened is it was right before the release of Dance with My Father, which coincidentally, Luther's father had diabetes and died when Luther was just 11 years old. So it was kind of a strange coincidence that that song came out right when this happened. And, you know, I was someone who always dreamed of working in showbiz. I started in small theater, then I worked up to regional theater, and then I got a big break, obviously, working for Luther. And so when that happened, it just shattered my life, and, you know, it just stopped that dream. And at that moment, I just could not believe that I had no idea that something as devastating and debilitating as a stroke could happen from diabetes. So that's what really inspired me to want to do outreach. And then Luther's good friend, Pat LaBelle, performed at a Luther tribute concert in New York at Madison Square Garden. And during her set, she stopped the show and said she was living with diabetes, but diabetes doesn't control her. She controls her diabetes. And that's when I looked up at the stage and she just looked so beautiful. And I thought, you're not a diabetic, you're a diva. And that's when the word Divabetic popped into my head. And then I got home and I wrote the word Divabetic out and I realized it was diabetic with a V standing for Vandross. And then I flipped the paper over and I wrote sugar's a bitch, not me, on the back. And from there I started making t-shirts. I sold t-shirts to raise money for diabetes nonprofits because I was a caregiver at that point. Luther was in recovery from the stroke, and like a lot of caregivers you lose your life in that process. And so Divabetic became something I could do when I wasn't being the caregiver. And that's really where that all began in 2003. So this year is my 20th anniversary in starting diabetes outreach, Divastat.
Yeah, of course. That's awesome. So through that whole event with Luther, what do you know today and what do you want to tell people today about diabetes that you've learned and you've experienced that can make a difference in their lives?
Well, the biggest thing I learned was this idea about going it alone. You know, Luther had like 50 people on the road helping him with his music and off stage and on stage and costumes and lighting. But when it came to managing type 2 diabetes, he did it alone. And I think that, to me, looking back, I would say that was a mistake. So right after that happened, my older brother was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, which, you know, it's called juvenile diabetes, but obviously if you're in your 30s, you're not juvenile. So I said to my parents, we need to get educated. So I think the biggest lesson was educating the people around you about diabetes, at least knowing how to treat a high or low, or knowing what, if there's an issue, what medications to give someone, you know, how would you treat that person? So that has always been the biggest thing for me, is empowering the people around you. And Divabetic, we say, like, creating your healthcare entourage. And I know, you know, specifically from the work I've done, type 2, there's a lot of shame and blame and a lot of embarrassment. So sometimes that's a real challenge to start talking to friends and coworkers. You know, I was a coworker, but friends, family, and coworkers about living with diabetes because they could judge you or react in a negative way to you. So you have to really, you could take that slowly in doing it, but it is important to do that because you feel the other person feels powerless. I felt really powerless about what happened to Luther. I was vilified as the assistant. When I started it, people were judging me. They said it was my fault. They blamed me. A lot of people also blamed me for even wanting to speak out about it. They thought, you know, we should just talk about his musical legacy. We shouldn't talk about that. That's a private matter. And then, you know, I was interviewed on a TV show, and the woman backstage, who was another guest, told me I should be ashamed of myself. And I had carried that so long that when she finally said it, after doing the amount of work I had done, it meant nothing to me. And I was so happy that someone said it, because it just allowed me to realize that whatever I was carrying around wasn't that big a deal. The work I was doing to help other people was much more important than what someone could say to me.
Wow. So there's an aha moment right there. Yeah, that probably, okay. I mean, that was probably life-changing for you.
I mean, the whole experience, I mean, definitely had PTSD from the Luther thing. I mean, after he had the stroke, the entire world was calling me, you know, Oprah, whoever you want to think, just, you know, people were holding prayer vigils for Luther and his care. You know, he's in ICU every day. We didn't know if he's going to make it or not. Then he did recover, you know, enough to go into rehab. He didn't, you know, it was just a whole process. And of course his recovery was, never what people anticipated or expected. And it, and I lost my dream. I had achieved something that no one else in my family or around me had ever done. And somehow I got to that place where I was working for someone. I idolized Luther growing up. I always listened to R&B music. I mean, working for Luther was not like I didn't know who he was. That was a real like idol of mine. And so to be working with him, and he moved me to New York, I mean, just everything, he just changed my life. So I decided to stay for those reasons. And I'm so glad I did. And that aha moment was just a series of moments. And the other aha moment for me was like, Luther had a very public battle with weight. And, you know, I really saw that his weight put his mind in a prison because he just couldn't get past it. So no matter what success he achieved through record sales or prestige from peers or award shows, you know, if he wasn't, if his weight, his weight wasn't in the right management, it didn't matter. And so, you know, I always preach to people that you have to be happy with where you are right now. And that I don't think it's about shape or size. I think it's about attitude, because I believe the person who wakes up in the morning, no matter what they, how big or small or whatever they are, if they get up and they get dressed up like it's a church social and they put on their best, that person is going to want to take care of their health, especially managing their care, because diabetes takes a lot of work. It's a person who wakes up and doesn't want to look in the mirror, throws on the sweats, doesn't really care. That's a person who's kind of heading down the highway with the lights off in the dark and is going to have an episode similar to Luther's in some way.
Yeah. Interesting. I mean, I know that as a person living with diabetes, I've been shamed. I mean, people who don't know about the disease love to have an opinion without any kind of fact about it. And it does kind of wear on you, or it can wear in on you. You know, like in a restaurant, well, hey, you can't eat cheeseburgers. Why are you eating a cheeseburger? You know, that kind of thing. And that's even a minor thing. But, you know, there is some like shame and guilt associated that I think to get healthy, you've got to kind of figure out a way for you to get beyond that kind of feelings from people.
Absolutely. It's about acceptance. I identified with it because I'm gay, and I immediately saw a correlation between the idea of coming out and type 2 diabetes and admitting it. It's not that journey of acceptance. I've been out since the mid 80s. It doesn't end. It's an onion that you keep peeling back, or an artichoke, whatever your food reference would be.
Yeah.
So I've always identified with that. I've always seen the journey of acceptance and, you know, the bargaining you do, you know, it's like the 5 stages of grief and how you get to that place where you have some kind of ownership. And it's only through ownership. And I could talk about this because I'm not living with diabetes. I have a brother with type 1, family history of type 2. I'm trying to delay getting diabetes. I think that I consider myself pre-diabetic. That's never come up in my records yet, but it just, from what I've learned, I'm just trying to delay that diagnosis. But I could truly identify, because of my sexual identity, about how painful and poisonous those thoughts of shame and blame could be from you reaching your ultimate goals. And when talking about diabetes, obviously we're talking about optimum health.
Right. Well, Max, here we are, 2023. What's on the docket this year for the Divabetic? Tell everybody about your outreach and some of the projects that you're doing. And I mean, I've had the honor to be part of some of the projects in the past years. It's just been amazing for me, and the opportunities were great. So what's happening this year, and tell everybody just what your mission is and what you're going to be doing.
Well, you know, another aha moment for me was like when I said I took my family to get educated about diabetes. You know, they're presenting it in a lecture style A to Z, and I'm a very active learner, and it really bothered me that if I wanted to hear about neuropathy, I had to wait through A to that letter. So I've always tried to approach diabetes education in the fun and entertaining way, and tip my hat to Luther and the other great entertainers I've had the opportunity to work with about making it entertaining. So our outreach has always had a focus since the very beginning of making it fun and glamorous to learn about living well with diabetes. And so I do, we have videos on YouTube. I used to do man in the street interviews where I'd go out and just quiz people about the favorite foods they like and the foods they don't like, because I'm a very picky eater. And I thought it was really important to talk to people about what they don't like for you to convince someone for me to try it. I also, you know, quiz people about diabetes, like ask people what organ produces insulin. And one of my funniest videos was a guy telling me it was in his testicles. I still think that's very funny. And then I do those videos. And then I've been hosting a podcast myself for 12 years and I never missed a month. And so we have a whole series of different podcasts where I've interviewed experts. And three of the shows I really love is I do an annual tribute podcast to Luther Vandross because I'm so proud to have worked with him. The second one I do, which is going to air shortly, is every January we do a guided meditation with my friend Rachel Zinman. She's living with LADA diabetes, latent adult diabetes autoimmune, and it's right. Like 0.1, 0.5, and it takes a long time to get that diagnosis correct. A lot of times you're misdiagnosed. So I like to do a guided meditation with her, not for that reason, but because I like to kind of give people a chance to restart the year and get focused. I think today more than ever, we're bombarded with messages. And so to really hone in on yourself and your health, you kind of have to like really take a minute to recharge. And so I like to kick off with that. And then we also produce and present a mystery podcast every year. And you were so fortunate that you've been in several of them. And last year we did one called Tomorrow's Not on the Menu. And it was really about the idea that your weight isn't the be end all to managing your diabetes, and that you could manage your weight. I mean, your diabetes at any size. So right. I wanted to put, I just, again, because of what I saw with Luther, I've always really kind of in the back of our outreach focused on this idea of like, can we just get off the scale and get into managing diabetes?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. And so those are all available on Blog Talk, iTunes, and actually Spotify for free. And there's like 150 episodes now, and there's a lot of videos. And then I also do baking parties with the diabetic pastry chef on Zoom, and that's sugar-free baking. And she talks a lot about how to alter the recipe, maybe not completely without sugar, but ways to like definitely cut down on the carbs and things like that.
Right. Yeah, she's awesome. So Max, just so everybody knows, I will post in the show notes all your links everywhere that they can find you. So in your mind, what do you think the biggest challenge diabetics face regarding eating today?
Confusion and chaos. I think there's so many messages out there. One minute you shouldn't eat eggs, the next minute you should eat eggs. One minute, you know, don't have sugar, the next minute don't have diet sugar substitutes because they could trigger more sugar consumption. What are total carbs on the, you know, just everything. I mean, I think the chaos of the messages, and I really think this idea that we love to tell each other what to do rather than just let you do what you need to do. But probably, like for me, I think the availability of processed food is definitely a challenge to make sure that it's so apparent, it's so everywhere accessible. And if you're not going to do, if you're trying to avoid processed food, it's difficult.
It is. And one size doesn't fit all. So everyone is a little bit different in the way they eat and the way they need to eat and exercise. You know, I get frustrated when I see this, you know, if you're a diabetic, you must do things. Here's the 10 foods you must not eat. You know, those things frustrate me because really, are you saying I could never eat a baked potato ever again? And there's such weird information out there on the internet. And I think challenging to find the right sources for people.
Right. And, you know, sometimes the advice is boring about sticking to a schedule. You know, most people, a lot of people get in a food rut too. That would be a problem too, is how do you get out of a food rut? And you get used to certain foods and those are habits and you find yourself going back to them no matter what anyone tells you. So part of it too is like, I think sometimes it's just being able to be confident in your choices, because no matter what you choose to do, someone's going to tap you on the shoulder like Jiminy Cricket and tell you, oh, I think you should do it this.
So Max, when you were growing up, what was your earliest food memories? Tell us about the food or dishes and maybe about the people that prepared it that really create memories for you.
Well, surprisingly to everyone, if they saw me, I am Italian. My mother's father was born in Abruzzi, Italy, and came to America at 16. And her mother is Sicilian, and she was born in this country. So my favorite food memory is every other Sunday, we would go to my grandmother's house, and she would serve an Italian meal for lunch. So she would serve the pasta dish, which she made herself, all kinds of pasta. Then she would do a roast chicken. And then we would have, she would warm nuts on a cookie tray in the oven with grapes, which I never, you know, I have to be honest, like until I really moved to New York and got more invested in the Italian community, I had never seen the roasted nuts before. And then when I saw it, it kind of came flooding back that my grandmother used to do that. So for me, like the ultimate comfort food, the thing that I reach for all the time is Italian. And, you know, I indulge myself by going to, I live near Italy in New York City. So I'll go get fresh pasta and bring it. And I have never tried to make my own sauce or do those things. My brothers do it, but I have never tried to do it. And I was attempting to make a lasagna and it was really awful. See, as a cook, I love to do things, but I refuse to really follow a recipe. I look at a recipe as a conversation, and invariably, even if I take it to the store, I will start altering it in my head, and then I can't duplicate it. So more times than not, I'll make a recipe for myself and nail it, and then I'll have people come over and I'll fail it. So like Brussels sprouts are probably one of my favorites to do. You know, I'll steam, I'll boil my Brussels sprouts for like 8 minutes to get rid of some of that bitterness, and then I'll cut them open. And I'll roast them with olive oil. I love olive oil, a little salt and pepper, and maybe something else on them. And normally, if I'm doing it for myself or even my boyfriend, it's okay. But if I have friends over, they're like, either I overcooked them, I didn't cook, you know, it's just crazy. So, you know, it's, everyone knows that I'm the inconsistent cook. Well, you know, and my grandfather made his own wine. He used to make my Italian grandfather. Now, my dad's side of the family was Polish. And so I obviously love pierogies because that's still more pasta and a potato. You can't really lose them. So, but really, like, I would say I radiate around an Italian meal all the time. And when I was in Italy with Lionel Richie years and years ago, I remember that the ravioli were like the size of a starfish, you know, like,
They're like, big.
I was like in heaven. I couldn't wait.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Very cool. Max, do you have a quote? Do you have a success quote? Do you have something that kind of like when you get up in the morning, you think about it, or, you know, something you could share with the folks out there that might be inspiring? Maybe a quote you live by.
My group exercise instructor, Troy, says another one in the books after we finish a workout. And like my favorite quote, because I think I enjoy being active. And, you know, like with New Year's resolutions right now, I hate this idea that, you know, people don't hit their resolutions. And I certainly hate to have something hanging over my head or a regret. So I love, like it says, another one in the books, because I finished the workout, I'm done, and I feel great. And I think that success is the pat on the back for doing it versus me kind of trying to find the inspiration or will to even do the workout. So when I think success quotes, I think of after, because it doesn't mean I did. It doesn't mean I worked out 5 days that week or 5 hours that day. It just means I did something for my body and my health. And I love, that's my favorite quote.
Okay, Max, what else would you like to talk about?
Well, I think we want to talk about, we were going to talk a little bit more just about things I've learned through diabetes, right? You wanted to talk, you know, and I think a lot of it, like you were saying earlier, is about this all, you know, one all or nothing approach or one size fit all approach. And I think over the years, what I've learned from everyone is just from interviewing experts, from interviewing people with both type 1 and type 2, as well as people affected by diabetes, is just kind of curating your own plan, and certainly starting with a small idea. And I truly believe in my heart that, you know, it's not about, well, for me, for other people could be, but it's starting with a small idea. It's a very simple start and just keep building that way. But I think for me, like having sitting down and really keeping a food diary was super helpful for me to realize, Am I being mindful? That's one of the things we're talking about at Divabetic this year too, is being mindful about what we're doing. So many times you may find yourself eating and you're watching TV, or you're looking, you're scrolling through your phone, or you're not focused on what you're actually doing. And I also am a fast eater. So that's been a challenge for me, is to work through slowing down as I eat and allowing my body to process that food versus just quote unquote shoveling it in my mouth. And I think that's a really important thing for people to think about, is like, how do you enjoy food? Because everyone has a very different emotional relationship with the food they're eating that we might not even know. We could be sitting across from the table and not realizing if they're in ecstasy or agony. And so I think we're coming back to that again this year, because how do you get out of a food rut if you don't like food? And most people I know with diabetes don't want to think about food. I mean, the number one thing I would say that most people say who are initially diagnosed to me is, I have to start thinking about food. I don't want to think about food. And that creates problems for them completely, because then they might become obsessive about food. It just starts this whole kind of friend or foe relationship with food, which is what you do by showing people different ways to eat foods and different ways to enjoy them and different ways to add things to change the taste and flavor to kind of wake up people's palate, I think is so important. Because I just think for people with diabetes, you really have to sit down and not even talk about, is it a carb? Is it a protein? What are you feeling at the table? I do it a lot to myself when I feel like, because I'm definitely, sometimes I'll eat for, like I said earlier, I'll eat for comfort. I'll be stressed out about something and I just want to reach for something. You know what I mean? And obviously during the holidays, I was getting boxes of, cookies and truffles at my office.
Right.
And, I found myself going back to the truffle box, and I'm not even a big chocolate person, but I'm definitely like, if it's in your house, it's in your mouth kind of person sometimes. So
right,
I always had to be very, I like to put something between me and that temptation, just something small that I have to kind of get out of automatic and think about it. I really want that,
What would that be? I mean, what do you put between yourself?
I don't buy it. So like, I'm not a big ice cream person, but of course, during 90 degree weather in New York, like I'm sure you have humidity. I want to talk. I'll do Italian ice. I would not buy it. I won't buy a box of it. I'll force myself to go get it, because then it's like 10 blocks away. So do I want to walk 10 blocks in 90 degree weather to have that Italian ice? And if I do, then I'm really going to enjoy it, because I just kind of like stop myself from being automatic and just making it that easy to get it. I would say, that's probably it. I'm sure there's, and like in my office, I remember reading this thing too about people who live closer to fast food eat more fast food, which is so obvious. I mean, this is not brain surgery, but I live in New York City. I live in Manhattan. There's a Popeyes like a block away. So I remember reading that and asking myself, like, oh my gosh, I've been eating Popeyes, fairly regularly. And it just made me think, and again, like I just mentioned earlier, I have Eataly like 6 more blocks away. So why would I go to Popeyes when you have the Emporium of Italian food? Like my utopia is only a few more blocks away. So it actually was really helpful to me to kind of see that information, because I just felt like just having that knowledge that because it's in such close proximity, again, I'm making automatic choices that maybe if I just stop for a minute and realize like I'm only doing that out of convenience, I don't know if I really want that, then if I choose to have it, I'm okay with it, because I thought about it a little bit more. And this is these are difficult things, but they are challenging. Again, going back to people with diabetes, some of these thoughts are, some people listening are not going to want to do that. They're shaking their head, because it is a lot to ask yourself to start thinking about what you're eating, because when you think about what you eat, a lot of us become obsessive and start eating more because of it.
Yeah.
And I love the one too about I did an outreach. I used to do a lot of outreach at hair salons. And one of the things that I thought was really important to talk about was what you put in your coffee or your tea in the morning. What we found out is it's all habit. You know, when you first start drinking coffee, a lot of times you might start very young. So you're putting like 5 or 6 teaspoons of sugar in it initially. But then 20 years later, you're 30 years old. And this is true. If you go to Dunkin' Donuts or Starbucks, you could hear people just saying 7 scoops of sugar. And you really have to ask yourself, why are you asking for that much now that you when you initially started drinking it? Could you go down a teaspoon? Could you go down 2 teaspoons? Would you even consider it? You know, and would you consider using a different milk? Blah, blah, blah. A lot of people, again, that's a very mindless thing that you do. That could be the thing that jumpstarts you in another direction because you suddenly became aware of that first thing you put in your mouth in the morning. So, you know, that's like, to me, like one of those bite-sized things that, you know, you could try it for a couple of days, and if it doesn't work for you, then go move on.
Right.
The other thing I'm doing in 2023 is I'm partnering with 2 authors, Janice Rosler, who's a sex therapist, and Donna Rice, and they wrote a book for the American Diabetes Association about diabetes and intimacy, and ADA shut down their consumer book division, so they got the book back. So now we at Divabetic are going to be publishing Sweet Romance. It's going to be an ebook out on Amazon, and it's going to be we're coming out with the first version, which is a woman's guide to love, diabetes, and intimacy, and then we're going to come out with the men's guide, and then we're going to come out with a couple's guide. So next year we'll be talking a lot about sexual wellness. And so it's something that I don't like to duplicate what's already out there. The ABCs of diabetes are everywhere, but the bedroom isn't. So, you know, I'm okay with going into the bedroom. I look back at my years with Luther, and I think he was an addict because his weight would fluctuate like over 100 pounds 6 or 7 times while I worked with him. And when he was at his heaviest, he was operating like an addict and using whatever that was, whether it was a sugar, you know, any kind of carb was really what his addiction was. And I have to tell you, in the last 20 years, we become much more respected. It's become more respected to talk about food addiction or sugar addiction or something like that. But back then it wasn't. And I just feel like that also, you know, like you're saying, you know, if it's near you, it becomes hard. And I worked with high voltage Kathy Dolgen. She wrote a book called Sugar Savvy. I used to go into the school systems with her and teach healthy eating. And I would make over the cafeteria, how much added sugar are you having every day? And people could look this up, but the American Heart Association, I believe, says no more than 6 tablespoons of sugar for a man and no more than 5 tablespoons of sugar for a woman in 24 hours. Mm-hmm. So it's like, something, you know, that, because that was a real trigger. They found that sugar, it isn't about willpower. It's sometimes about body chemistry. And so this idea that you're beating yourself up when your body chemistry is addicted to that food is problematic.
Max, this has been amazing. It's awesome to have you here. I think you've really hit on some really interesting components. Why don't you tell everyone, and again, we'll post all the links in the show notes, but for someone walking, driving, sitting in their kitchen right now, listening, what's the best place to find you? Because I know as soon as they're done listening and wait till the podcast is over, to go check you out. Where should they go first?
That's a great question. I guess our website, divabetic.org, or Facebook. I post there fairly regularly.
All right. Well, Max, thank you for hanging out with us for a few moments. Anything else you want to add before we get into our game of the podcast?
Oh, I'm ready. I love a game.
All right. So, so when we come back, Max, we're going to play the 411 rapid fire round. So stay tuned. We'll be right back. All right, everybody, welcome back. It's time to play the rapid fire 411 game with my friend Max. So Max, here's how the game is played. So I'm going to ask you a series of rapid fire questions, and you just simply choose which one you like. So for example, it might be butter or olive oil, riding a bike or hiking, that kind of thing. First thing that comes to your head. Are you ready to go?
And do I tell you why I chose it or no?
It's up to you. You can. Okay. Certainly. Okay. Whatever. How are you feeling? You're the guest. Let's do it. All right, here we go. Olive oil or coconut oil?
Olive oil. I don't like coconut.
Okay, me neither. Mango or banana?
Oh, I have a banana every day. Mangoes are impossible to cut, and they're super messy. If I have one, I'll eat the whole thing in one because it just becomes a total mess. But banana.
Banana. Okay. Waffles or pancakes?
Neither. If I had to choose, I would go with a thin pancake. I live in New York. It would be a bagel. I mean, you know.
Well, who doesn't love a good bagel from New York? All right. Chunky or smooth peanut butter?
Oh, I have chunky in my refrigerator right now. I'm just going to say chunky.
Okay. Valentine's Day or St. Patrick's Day?
Valentine's Day. Self-love. Always love.
Yeah.
Love, of course. You got to have love over luck. Love over luck.
Love over luck. I love that. Okay. Favorite vegetable?
I'm going to say Brussels sprouts.
Okay. I love them with balsamic vinegar on them. A really good quality balsamic vinegar.
I just saw this recipe on Instagram. I don't know if people fall down a rabbit hole with that, but they smash the, they steam it first, which I boiled it, like I told you
before.
And then they smash it and roast it. And then they have a dipping sauce with it. And I was like, bingo, I'm going to try.
Wow, that sounds great.
I want to try to do that. It probably will not come out that way when I do it. It will be much worse, but I will try.
Good for you. It's all about trying. Right?
Right.
Okay. Bacon or ice cream?
Bacon.
Coffee or tea?
Oh, coffee. Only coffee.
Me too. Superhero or super villain?
Hero.
Okay.
I used to read Marvel comics with my brother all the time when I would go visit my Italian grandmother. They costed a quarter, and I would go down and I would get the we would go read all the comics in that, you know, they used to have that rack, and then we'd buy five. My mother would give me a dollar, we'd buy four, and we would draw them. And, you know, I was in costume design and theater, so of course I would have to do the costumes, right?
Of course. Roller coasters or merry-go-round?
Carousel Museum. I'll say the merry-go-round, because the last time I was on the roller coaster at Coney Island, all I could think about is, My back's going out of alignment. Like on the ride. Like I just didn't enjoy it anymore because I just felt like, oh no, I had gone to the chiropractor. It's not going to hold.
All right. Finally, Max, if you could break bread with anyone, past or present, who would that be?
Oh, I think it would be Ben Franklin. I went to the Ben Franklin Museum in Philadelphia when I was doing outreach there, and or his home. And the man invented flippers after he invented everything else. Yeah. I would be really fascinated by Ben.
All right, Max. Well, thank you again for being on the show. This is going to be an epic podcast episode. So thank you very much for being here. I've cherished our friendship over the years and our collaboration over the years. And I'm looking forward to hanging out with you in 2023 in any way I can to make a difference in diabetes, people living with diabetes.
Well, thank you so much for making me happy today. I was looking forward to this podcast.
Yeah, awesome. Awesome. All right, Max, thanks for coming on the show, and have a great rest of your day.
All right.
So I know this is hard to believe, but I recently signed up for Medicare. Now, what about my Libre 2 system from Abbott? As my pharmacy was trying to figure it all out, all the complicated paperwork, I was getting a little frustrated, and quite honestly, so were they. So I called US Med to see if there was a better way. And guess what? There is. Their motto is better service, better care. It's what they call white glove service. I was worn out by having to make multiple trips to the pharmacy only to discover the orders were not even ready. Long lines, or they would say, we need to call your doctor. We need to get confirmation for the refill. It went back and forth and back and forth. And after about 2 weeks of this, I absolutely had it. I would reach out to the pharmacy and they would say, the doc never called us back, or they never followed up. That's the thing I hated the most. So my recommendation, head over to usmed.com/happydiabetic. Are you ready for US Med to always provide you 90 days worth of supplies with fast, free shipping? Yes, free shipping. Look, they carry everything from insulin pumps to diabetic testing supplies to the latest CGMs, the Freestyle Libre 2 and 3, and the Dexcom G6. You know my love for the Libre 2 system, and US Med is the number one distributor for the Libre 2 systems nationwide. Look, if you're just starting with Medicare like me, US Med should be your very next call. They accept Medicare nationwide and a broad private insurance coverage with over 800 private insurers, plus an A-plus rating from the Better Business Bureau. If you're looking for supplies from everything from insulin pumps to diabetes testing supplies to the latest CGMs, and you're looking for better service, easier service, delivered right to your door, free shipping, US Med is who you should be getting a hold of. Dial this number right now. Well, why don't you wait till the podcast is over? 888-885-0012, or simply go to usmed.com/happydiabetic. Don't wait any longer. Oh, wait a second. I think that's my doorbell. I think that's US Med delivering my 90-day supply now. Call them or go to the website usmed.com/happydiabetic now. Again, don't wait any longer. I want to remind everybody that I am a chef living with type 2 diabetes since 1998. I'm not a doctor. I'm not a certified registered dietitian or a diabetic educator. But I can tell you this, if you need advice on any of those topics, reach out to your medical professional team. They are there and ready to help. Our podcast is produced and directed and engineered by Jason Lewis. Our theme music by the Happy Diabetic Kitchen Band, and of course, our kitchen mascots, Scout and Tucker. Thanks for tuning in, everybody. And I want to thank my guest, Max Szadek, Mr. Divabetic. Thanks for being on the show today. And thanks for tuning in. And let me leave you with this thought. Federico Fellini once said, life is a combination of magic and pasta. So remember this, better this year than last year. Better this month than last month. Better this week than last week. And better this day than yesterday. So long, everybody. And remember, no one loves you more than me. See ya next time.